Good morning. I am Nikki, Creative Director of Transform Nursing, and today's live that I'm talking about is I Do Not Yield, Lessons from Maxine Waters. And if you don't know who Maxine Waters is, she is an American politician that represents the 43rd District of California, and she's really outspoken, especially when it comes to Trump and some of his politics. But even more importantly, she's a really influential person, and she uses her influence so that she can get her message across. So we're going to talk a little bit about that today. But before we dive in, I want to share with you a little bit about me and my work and its focus on training nurses globally to really understand and embrace social justice leadership, diversity and inclusion, and use the lens of cultural humility to do that. So you can find out more about me and my website at www.transformnursing.com. And you can also learn more about me with my course, The Nurses Influential Leadership Lab, which is all about really training nurses in social justice advocacy. And I also have a podcast that's coming soon. So stay tuned to the work that's happening. If you can hear me, hit like, and if you like what I'm saying, give me a thumbs up or give me a wow. Please share a comment. Tag someone if you feel like this is relevant or beneficial to them, and it's something that you think that they need to hear. So feel free to also let me know where you're listening from. I love to learn more about my audience and what people are doing and where you're coming from, whether you're a nurse or not. I think that this content is relevant, and it's here and it's up close and personal. So let's talk today. So Maxine Waters has a video, which I'm going to share with you in this feed. And in the video, she is speaking to Mike Kelly, who is also in Congress. And the way the video starts anyway, I don't know how the whole thing starts, but the way the video starts is Mike Kelly is basically telling her, for the most part, that he is trying to make America great again, right? And that the best way to do that is to stop talking about discrimination and come together as a nation in spite of what Maxine Waters is saying. Mike Kelly is a white man. Maxine Waters is a black woman, African-American woman. And my first thought is, what do you think about that? What do you think about someone saying that the best way to make America great again is to stop talking about discrimination? Do we need to stop talking about discrimination? Are we making that too much of a point? Are we making, you know, this whole conversation around diversity and inclusion too much of a point? Is it changing and skewing the message? So that's the first question that I want you to think about. And in her response, when she was asked to yield her time by the chair, Maxine Waters said, "I will not yield one second to you." And I think this is an infamous line because she's saying two things. I will not yield, and I will not yield my time, my energy, and I will also say what it is that I need to say. And she talked about being offended as an African-American woman. She talked about it's Mike Kelly's president that's dividing the country. She talked about attitudes towards women. There was a lot of really incredible stuff that was really in there. And they wanted to stop her in the middle. The chair tried to stop her in the middle and tell her to yield. And she kept telling him that she wouldn't yield. And she made it a point to say that he didn't ask Mike Kelly to yield, that he had only asked her to yield. So you may be asking, why am I doing this live? Why is Nikki doing a live in her car, as you can clearly see? Because it's quiet in here. Why is Nikki doing a live as a nurse about Maxine Waters, who is a politician? Well, as you know, nursing and health policy are very much so embedded in one another. And I believe that nurses have to take more of an influential approach to health policy. But even on a deeper level, this kind of conversation connected me. It connected me to two people who were really talking about bigger things, about discrimination, and talking about, you know, being a woman in this country. And what I started to look at was the subtleties and the politics that I saw. So if you pull everything back and you just look at what you're seeing, what you can see is, if you just listen to what you're hearing, what you can see, you see a white man speaking, you see a white chairman also directing, and you see a black woman who is also responding and speaking. What you'll notice in these conversations is that these are not inclusive spaces, right, that we have in Congress. This definitely was an example of inclusion. And my focus is on building inclusive leadership. And inclusive leadership is not about setting the table for everybody and then saying, come eat at the table. Inclusive leadership is actually about saying to everyone, you're all invited to this table. We're going to set it together. And the very fact that Maxine Waters felt like she had to force herself into this this conversation shows us that inclusive leadership was not a part of this framework at all, right? But this is how we become inclusive leaders, to lead on many levels. And I looked at this from many different levels, and I was moved by this as a woman. I was moved by this as a nurse. I was moved by this as a mother. As a wife, I was moved in different ways, but the biggest thing that really struck me and stood out to me was white privilege. So I want to talk a little bit about white privilege, and I want to talk about it from a level of academia, and I'm hoping that you'll hear me and that you'll understand what I'm saying. So let's do some definition. What is white privilege? Why is Nikki bringing this up? She's a nurse in this context. Obviously, in the context of justice, this is relevant. So let's share and talk a little bit about it is a societal privilege that benefits people whom society identifies as white beyond what is commonly experienced by non-white people under the same social, political, or economic circumstances. And Peggy McIntosh, she is actually the white woman who coined this term and expression, describes it as an invisible package of unearned assets. And these include some of the following: cultural affirmations of one's own worth, presumed greater social status, and freedom to move by work, play, and speak freely. And in this conversation that Maxine Waters was having with Mike Kelly, you could clearly see some things that were happening. I could clearly see that there was definite cultural affirmation between white male and white male, right? And this was a black female that was talking, and you could clearly see that she was being cut off as she was speaking. And so that made me question, do we respect women? Bottom one, as one question. And then it made me think of how little respect sometimes we have for African American people. But I want us to pause for a minute. So let's pause. So if you are a white person, please take a moment and share your experiences of what it means to be white in America. And I'm happy if you just share a sentence, or a thought, a word, it doesn't matter, nothing grand. And if you're a non-white person, I want you to do the same. Please take a moment to share your experiences of what it means to be non-white in America. And what I'd like to do is see the difference, if there is a difference at all, right? I mean, there's been tons of research that says that there is a difference, but I like to know from you. I like to know if you perceive that. What I have found is that the effects of privilege, especially white privilege, can be seen in professional, educational, and personal contexts. But the concept of white privilege also implies the right to assume the universality of one's own experiences, making others or marking others as different or exceptional while perceiving oneself as normal. So we see that all the time, right? So I call white folk dominant culture. So in white folk are dominant culture, so they are the norm. Everything is set around them. And we are constantly having to be mindful of what dominant culture is doing. But here's the rub. Even if people are scared to talk about race, and even if they feel like there's some type of connotation to that, does it really matter? What is the real fear, right? And there's all kinds of other things that we could talk about here. But what I want people to understand, especially people who are white to understand, is that talking about white privilege has very little to do with racism. It has little to do with you being racist and everything to do with a system of racial structure that has, again, set people up to be different by society standards, okay? That's what white privilege is. It's not this privilege of, oh, I'm white and I'm rich. No. You don't have to be white and rich. You can be white and poor and still have white privilege. And we can talk about that. I'd love for you to ask me questions about that. What it's really saying is that me as a non-white person, I have to study white people. I have to know you. I have to learn your culture. I have to learn your mechanisms, your ways, and your values, right? Because if I don't, I might not survive. You have the privilege of not having to learn anything about me ever if you so choose to, because you have the power to make choices and decisions based off of what it is that you do without having anything to do with non-white people. That's the privilege that I'm talking about. So hear me on that. So when Maxine Waters is using her influence and her position in the media to bring attention to this level of injustice, I think it's powerful. I do not yield. I, Nikki Akpirewa, do not yield. I am a social justice advocate. I am a nurse. I am a leader. I'm an entrepreneur. I am inclusive in the work that I do, and I do not yield. I do not yield to people who are not even aware. This is the job, is to become aware, and that is not my job to make you aware. It's actually your job to become that. I do not yield to people who are conceited and who do not believe this is a part of their work. I do not yield to people who think that they can use words and say them in such a way with strength and power to denote things, I do not yield to that. And so I invite us as nurses, and I invite us as influential leaders and as inclusive thinkers, not to yield. I invite us to learn some lessons from Maxine Waters about standing, standing our ground, saying what needs to be said, and being willing to put our truth on the line to be authentic to what it is that we know to be true. So if this topic is interesting to you, or if you want to learn more about it, especially about how to be more aware of your own biases, of unconscious bias, of how to really be a better and more effective provider to people of color, how to actually increase your ability to engage and communicate with communities who are non-white and with communities who are white as well, then I invite you to take my course, the Nurses Influential Leadership Lab. And you can find that in my website at transformnursing.com under the trainings tab. I'd love to get to know more about you. I'm happy to set up a one-to-one just so that I can learn and talk to you about what your efforts are and what your goals are when it comes to social justice. Or maybe you're thinking about what you can say to those who don't get it, who aren't woke, as I like to say it, or aware, or if they don't own their conscience. If you're curious about how to speak so that others get the message, then I want you to click on the link that I'm gonna leave here in my freebie, which is through the three-step guide to being an influential nurse leader. All right, I'm gonna drop that in the comments section. Thank you so much for your time. I'm gonna share all those links with you. Please share your comments, your thoughts, your insight. Love to hear it. I'm super excited about it. Keep up the good work. And my favorite quote is always for it. So let's continue for it. Take care. Have a great day.